I have a little MP3 recorder that I stick in the visor of my vehicle, on top of the visor, between the visor and the roof, and then I record as I'm driving. So I do a lot of recordings every day, actually, hours of recording, which is very, very helpful because it forces one to focus in and say, okay, what am I saying? What am I talking about? Let me develop this. And it is tremendous, tremendous. The last recording I did today was on the leverage, it's called leverage of nature. And that's worth mentioning. The way that existence works, even the way the Holy Spirit works, is with leverage, uses leverage. The Holy Spirit uses leverage to collapse time, to save us time. The ego uses leverage to delay, to try to get us to invest in more time. We use leverage over what we call nature to get stuff done. People that are successful, they have little gimmicks and leverage. They've learned to leverage, how to leverage situations. What we don't realize is that nature itself uses leverage. This is very important. And when we talk about nature, we're not talking just about the trees and the grass. We're talking about the cosmos. Okay. The cosmos uses leverage. We assume that everything is steady, pretty steady state. And it's the way that it is now is the way it's always been. Not true at all. Very untrue. There are times when nature uses leverage and causes drastic changes and changes things really intensely through leverage. Historically, if you go back through history, you will realize this is the truth. And scientists, to their credit, have discovered this. There's a lot of good science that's taking place, actually. It's just that scientists are not very good at certain things. They're good at some things, but other things they're not good at. There are very few generalists in science who are able to put everything together and then step outside the box of science. It takes a lot of leverage to do that. And to get this leverage, one needs to listen to the master of leverage, which is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will help give you leverage, use leverage, help you see outside the box. So, we're using a lot of leverage against this planet, a ton of leverage right now. The whole situation is extraordinarily leveraged, even in our, you know, financial system, the credit, etc. We have leveraged things to such an extent that we keep doubling down, actually. And this is causing a big, big problem for the planet. Big problem. The glamorizing of the body is the key mistake that we made. Religions prohibit certain things for a reason. They say, don't use this leverage. This could be used as leverage. Don't do it. Okay, don't do it. Why? Because they know throughout ancient history, there's a deep memory, a subconscious memory we have of ancient history, all the history on this planet. And nature strikes back. We've found out that when we use certain types of leverage, nature uses certain types of leverage against us, and it's not pretty at all. So, for various reasons, we have been told, look, there are certain things you don't do. Don't use this leverage. Don't glamorize bodies to sell products. Don't engage in usury. Okay, all this kind of stuff. Don't use stimulants. Don't use drugs, etc., etc. And we are so naive now as we think, oh, that's just a bunch of old superstitious myth. No, it's not. It comes from very great wisdom of recognizing leverage and how leverage can be used and what it can lead to. So we are in a situation right now where we have very foolishly used certain types of leverage that shouldn't have been used, and continue to do so and continue to double down on it. And this can very well bring about a reaction from nature which will be leveraged. By that I mean worse than we can expect. It's in certain intellectual circles. It's called a black swan event. but that's just one writer's term that someone picked up on. It's something that's way, way worse than we thought, than we expected, and more sudden and unexpected, and surprising, like, whoa, too fast, too strong, like a tsunami. You might call a tsunami a type of leverage that nature uses, actually. And you wonder if that leverage of nature didn't have something to do with telling us, hey, you know, shut down your nuclear power plants, okay? It's a bad idea. Nature doesn't like it. Now, we assume nature is dumb because we seem to have all this leverage over it. Not true. Not true at all. It has its own type of intelligence. And most certainly can respond in leveraged ways towards humanity, for sure. It's happened before. It has happened before. And since nature is cosmic, that includes all sorts of cosmic forces that can be used as leverage, including throwing a few pebbles at the earth. Say, hey, you guys, hey, knock off this leverage you're using here. Tossing some pebbles, you know, into the earth's atmosphere, as it were. Nature can do that. We don't understand that nature is an intelligent situation. It's an egoic situation. It is an arrogant situation. But that doesn't mean it's not intelligent. Arrogance can be very shrewd and intelligent. Okay. So nature says, hey, you're messing with my training program. You're out of whack. You know, in comes some stones. Toss a few pebbles in here and see what happens then. What happens then is dust blotting out of the sun. A lot of stuff happens. Nature can play hardball. It has played hardball in the past, and by all indications it will again. That's what we've been told. The leverage that we're using definitely would justify it. I mean, there's no question about it, that we have gone off the deep end. We have thrown away the key prohibitions that we have to hold fast to. We've thrown away. Disaster, that's a road to disaster. In our arrogance, we think, we're in control of nature. We're in control. Nothing bad can happen to us. That is absolute nonsense. Total nonsense. Reckless. You might even call it reckless insanity. Do we really understand the working of the cosmos? We think it's like some mechanism, some clock. It is not a mechanism. It can be very arrogant and capricious and leveraged if it wants to. We think that everything's just, like physics is just, everything's just working through physics, and therefore, if we don't see any problem, there isn't any problem, or, you know, we just think it's in some kind of inert, what we might call it, just this like a clock that's just working. It's set. Everything's already set, and it'll just continue to work this way. Nothing can be further from the truth. Crazy, crazy, crazy ignorance to think that way. The universe can act and react. If it doesn't like something, it will take steps to change it. It'll send a comet in here. It'll send something in here. It'll decide, the sun will decide to do something. You know, the earth will decide to do something. Believe me, it uses leverage. So this is just warning people, telling them that for sure we've gone down the wrong path. Absolutely. By usury and credit society, very bad idea. Very bad idea. Glamorizing bodies to sell products, very bad idea. What happens is you start borrowing and doing things on credit, and you need to pay it back. In order to pay it back, you need to sell more. You need to be more successful. In order to be more successful, you need to be more successful in marketing your product. And the easiest way to do this is to use bodies, glamorous bodies, to sell your products. Okay. And that starts a very, very big problem. Other people start doing it, etc., etc., etc. That's what's happened. There should be prohibitions against, one, lending, credit, absolutely prohibitions against that. Because then you have to work harder. This whole system is designed to get you to work harder and harder and harder and harder, more and more productive, more and more effective in marketing. You've got to pay your creditors back. You're under a crunch. There's a ton of competition. You end up taking, people start taking stimulants like caffeine, cocaine, etc. And they're super productive. And then they get ahead. You see, they get more. And then people say, wait a minute, I want more. And how do I get more? Use glamorized bodies to sell more, to induce people to buy into what you're marketing more and more and more. And then others use more glamorized bodies so they can compete and get ahead of you. And the whole society starts swirling down the drain with this sort of a trifecta of credit, glamorizing bodies, and using stimulants. It leads to disaster, actually, because we keep finding, hey, we can leverage things this way. Isn't this incredible? And of course, it starts with our own arrogance of trying to be happy with existence, which we cannot. Try to make existence lovely, which we cannot, because the very means of perceiving existence is completely vulnerable, right? Our perceptions, our body, completely vulnerable, not stable, has problems. So we feel it's threatened. So our perception of everything is threatened, continuously threatened, as are everything we perceive. It's a double whammy here. So we try to get more and more and more. We want to feel secure. So we get more credit. We get more enterprise. We say, hey, if we take stimulants, we can work harder, we can work faster, we can work smarter. Hey, if I use glamorized bodies, we can sell more, we can get more interest, you know. We can drive ourselves more and more and more. And as we do that, it causes more and more exploitation of the earth, more and more exploitation of the resources, and more pollution, more and more damage to the infrastructure, the ecosystem of the earth. And that is what we've done. That is what we've done. Which is why religions say, no stimulants, no glamorizing the body, no use of the body in advertising, for sure. No glamorizing it. Don't glamorize the body at all. Cannot use it to sell any products whatsoever. Very important. And no lending, no usury, no credit, that kind of thing. Now, of course, temporarily in the short term, we have this massive glut of affluence, but that is short term. We don't realize that nature is going to leverage against us, against our leverage. You know, we're action, reaction. And by decimating the planet as we've done, by selling all these products because of these beautiful, glamorous bodies, they're saying, hey, look at, you know, holding products there, and you think, wow, you know, you react to that, and then using stimulants that get you even more reactive and fanning the flames of materialism and competition and consumerism and buy, et cetera, et cetera. All this stuff. We keep on exploiting the planet. We need get all the petroleum out of the planet so we can fertilize all the crops and grow all the cotton for all our fancy clothes and have more and more people, et cetera, et cetera. So these are the things that we're not supposed to do. So we have gone down the wrong road in a bad, bad, bad way. And people have tossed aside these things as if they were just like super nonsense, superstition. And those who do that are simply incredibly arrogant. Incredibly arrogant. They're so arrogant they're blinded. We say pride goeth before a fall, meaning arrogance goes before a fall. You know, they're so arrogant they don't even see. They don't even see the bigger picture at all. They don't understand that nature uses leverage too. They don't understand that, but it most certainly does. And what I've seen is that nature is going to use leverage against the situation here. It's going to bring a halt to it. It's going to bring a screeching halt to it. And we cannot comprehend that. In our arrogance, we say, it's impossible. What do you mean? What are you talking about? It's impossible. No, it's not. Throw a few pebbles into this planet, and that'll bring things to a screeching halt. Just ask the dinosaurs. They're thinking that might have been a comet, actually, that struck. Some large body, asteroid or comet, but it was a comet. Comets have an incredible amount of energy because of the speed, whereas asteroids are not going very fast. Comets are going super fast, super, super fast. This one, iSun, or NOSI, that's coming in is going incredibly fast. It's a very fast comet. You get some fragments of that comet coming into Earth with the velocity that they have, and the impact and devastation would just be, you know, near extinction level event. So nature doesn't play around. It plays hardball. It plays leverage. It just, because the whole purpose, of course, of nature, of existence, is to teach spirit how to die. So it's a nasty business, and nature knows its business. Now, this world is a training ground to teach people how to die, teach spirit how to die, rather, which, of course, is impossible. And nature may say, hey, you're messing with the planet. We want to keep it the way it is. Or nature may say, we're going to change the planet into a different configuration, actually, and put more pressure on you, etc. So you cannot trust nature at all. It uses leverage. We have this delusional belief that nature is this kind, nice, sugary, flowery thing. Nothing could be further from the truth. That's an extremely myopic viewpoint. And we have these, you know, nature goes on a rampage, and we have a lot of catastrophes and stuff, but still we shrug them off and say, oh, well, it's not that big of a deal. Well, there's many things that can be a big deal. Like, for instance, what if the methane gas in the Arctic area, what if it, for some reason, that the global warming released a massive amount of that, you know, that would be a game changer, to say the least. There are pockets, empty pockets, perhaps, in the planet's structure beneath the oceans that could collapse. You could have some area of under the oceans collapse. The ocean level suddenly, you know, drop, and then the reaction would all go down, and then all collide together, and then push back up, and we could create, you know, massive tsunamis. You could have places that, like, huge landslides in the ocean, like the Canary Islands, etc. There's actually just a massive amount of things that could happen on this planet. But the most likely one that I've seen is stones from space, which has happened here quite a few times, actually. See, the ancients were not stupid at all. They really were not. They just had a different way of being. We think that we're really sophisticated. Well, we may be sophisticated, but we're sophisticated savages, actually. The ancients had an appreciation for what nature can do if it wants to. And they had gotten the information that they need to knock off certain behaviors. Gambling is another one. Drugs, alcohol, that's another one. There's a lot of things. There's lots of ways to go wrong here, of course. In fact, you really cannot go right except by repenting. But by at least living your life a certain way, you're not going to bring about the wrath of nature, leverage nature upon you. And you are able to develop a greater calm, greater focus, and are able to then begin to see, to recognize and accept and be disillusioned from our arrogance, which, again, what is perception? Perception is arrogance denying that it's arrogant. That's perception. Arrogance, what can it do? It has to deny that it's arrogant. The definition of arrogance is the belief that spirit can accomplish the impossible. That's arrogance. That's what it is. So, of course, arrogance says, oh, yes, I can. Yes, I can do that. So it's denying that it's arrogant. It says, if I can do it, it's not arrogant. So it denies that it's arrogant. The arrogance denying that it's arrogant is perception. That is perception. The denial is what we call perception. Now, arrogance saying, oh, I am arrogant because it is impossible. In other words, arrogance accepting that it's arrogant is called repentance. And repentance has its own perception. That has a different type of perception. And the important cast casts a loveliness upon everything, and more importantly, it's invulnerable. Okay, that's very important. It's invulnerable. So the means of perceiving is invulnerable. Crucial. Whereas here, with arrogance, denying arrogance, its perception is through the senses, which are vulnerable. Which is what arrogance believes, that reality is vulnerable. So it's the very means of its perceiving, its denial of self, is vulnerable, because it believes in vulnerability. So of course our eyes are going bad, all our senses are going bad, and we can be dead, you know, just like that, and we wouldn't be seeing anything. So the key is that the means of perception be invulnerable and be steady and last flawlessly as long as there's a necessity, a need, a use for that perception. So arrogance, accepting that it is arrogant, meaning it's trying to accomplish the impossible, which is repentance, has a mode of perception, a different mechanism of perception than the physical body senses. And this mode of perception is invulnerable. It's not vulnerable to anything. It's steady, it's smooth, it's calm, it's flawless, it's invulnerable, cannot be threatened in any way. It's totally stable, so the perception is always flawless. And that reminds us of reality, doesn't it? Where we don't need perception at all, where it's direct knowing. But this repentance perception has this quality of flawlessness and invulnerability to it. So in this world, no matter how much we gather, we're in this frantic, everyone's trying to get more and more and things that will last, and they don't realize it's the problem of the perceiver. The mechanism of perception is the problem. These bodies don't last. So you can have something so beautiful, and yet if you're wise, you realize, wait a minute, my perception of this is not going to last. Plus, everything that you have in this world is vulnerable to being wiped out in many, many ways. It can even be stolen from you, right? So it can be stolen from you, you can be killed, etc., etc. So no matter what you get this feeling like insecurity, like, wait a minute, I feel very insecure that this loveliness can slip right through my fingers. I can't really get a hold of it. So it's a catch-22. It's a lose-lose situation. It's a double whammy. Both the mechanism of perception and what is perceived is vulnerable. Both. Now, if you had a mechanism of perception that projected loveliness upon everything, and the mechanism of perception was flawless and invulnerable, then even though the dance of vulnerability continues among things, you probably would have a feeling of great loveliness and stability, because the means of perception is stable, you see? So that's a win-win, as it were. It would be even better if you were perceiving the death-free realm, the things there. But I would say, I don't know for sure, but it would seem, reason would say, well, if you're projecting loveliness upon everything, and the means of perception is supplying the loveliness itself, then you have no worries. That can solve a continuity problem right there. You're not vulnerable. There's no sense of vulnerability to this loveliness. This loveliness does not seem vulnerable at all, because the seeing is not coming from the body. It's not coming from the body. That's why the gurus, they're not afraid of death, or they're not worried about it at all. They say, it doesn't matter. It doesn't affect what I'm seeing at all. They say they don't even use the body's eyes for seeing. There's another mode of seeing that's not vulnerable. So this is very, very crucial. This is salvation. This is the information we have to have. And you know, a lot of people are just fishing in other places and not catching any fish. Now, when you know that the only problem we have is the continuity problem, and you know this Holy Spirit is the solution to the continuity problem, which means perception of repentance, the perception that repentance gives, which is arrogance, accepting that it is arrogant, then nothing is threatened. Your vision is not threatened at all. It doesn't matter what happens in the world. It doesn't matter at all. It has no effect on you. Everything's lovely. Everything has this incredible loveliness. Now, we wouldn't say it's perfect, but the loveliness is perfect. I mean, there still could be wars, and I'm sure there will be. I mean, there's all sorts of stuff going on. But for you, with vision of repentance, everything is lovely, just flawlessly, seamlessly lovely. So it is very important to hear this now, because we have to stay ahead of the events of the day. I'm aware of the events of the day and what's going on. And we have to stay ahead of it, ahead of the curve, because it's really, really coming, fraying and coming undone. It really is, very fast. And when once these things start going, they happen very fast. And history was full of examples of this. You cross certain thresholds, etc. And then it's just, once people double down too much, double down. And once arrogance keeps doubling down, then it starts believing its own advertising, and it gets lost unto any sense of repentance. It gets lost to it, and it just can't stop. It's like a runaway train. And we have a runaway train situation now. There's no question about it. But it's not important to pay attention to it. It's not important. Because again, repentance, the perception of repentance, is entirely lovely and unthreatened. The mechanism of perception cannot be threatened. Whether the body's alive or not, or whatever condition, doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You're not seen with the body. It's a spiritual mechanism of perception that the Holy Spirit provides for us. So, then whatever, you know, let whatever come doesn't matter. We don't have to follow the events of the day. We don't have to be freaking out as we see this fraying of the fabric of civilization taking place. And everything's beautiful. There's a song in the 60s, it's all so beautiful. But they got that on drugs, which is folly, because they're still using the mechanism of perception of the body. They're just altering the body's perception. So that's really folly, because again, I say, it's a new mechanism of perception. Repentance gives you a new mechanism of perception that's not based on the body at all. It's not based on the flesh at all. And that brings you a real peace and calm and serenity and feeling of safety. But drugs don't do that. Drugs don't do that at all. You have to try and score your next drugs. You have the hangover, the after effects. You have to deal with all these issues around it. And it doesn't last, and sometimes it's not so good, and all this nonsense. Drugs are definitely not the way. In fact, they are a way of self-deception, of arrogance, actually. Drug use comes from arrogance. That is very much a fact. Thinking, oh no, we can make this world lovely. There's a way that arrogance can make this world lovely. Yet maintain the means of perceiving it itself is completely vulnerable. See, which is just, insanity. Because, close your eyes, everything vanishes, right? Die, you're not seeing anything. You're not seeing any of this. So loveliness, there's no loveliness anymore for you as far as, perceiving it. Somebody can take you away from it. Somebody can lock you away in a room. Somebody, can do all of that. So the vision of repentance is not dependent on where your body is, what your body's doing. It's not dependent on the body's senses, etc., etc. If you're locked away in a deep dark dungeon, you still are perceiving this infinite vista of loveliness. Doesn't mean you're not dependent on what your body's eyes can see. You're not dependent on that. So these are things that the top gurus know, and it used to be knowledge among the cognoscenti, and it's really dwindled away to a dangerous extent, where people are really looking for love in all the wrong places, as it were. And we can talk endlessly about demagoguery and all these things that happen, etc., etc., etc. But the important thing is, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. We don't need to worry. It's too late for all these worries to bother us, because we have the information now. So why should we worry? This is true. Why should we worry? We should just relax and expand our feeling of calm and get ready to accept vision and experience it. You don't have to worry about what's going on. It's too late for that. It's too late to be bothered by all that. It's too late. Too late. Doesn't matter what happens in the world, it's too late. We already have the truth about salvation. It's already here. It's already grounded. It's already in, you know, concrete form. And it's explainable. You can listen to it, etc. So all these things, you see something happen and say, well, it's too late. It's too late for that to bother me. And it's literally true. It's too late for that to bother me. Now, if the giants collapse, as they may, that might bother me. But I can even say it's too late for that to bother me, too. And it might be a good thing if they do, then I don't have to pay any attention to it. So, that's just my little device, staying grounded. So, I appear to be a useful idiot here. You have to use devices, you know, to make yourself seem like a useful idiot here, for the most part. Otherwise, people will really put the pressure on you. Now, if you have vision, it probably won't affect you, because you know that no matter what anybody does or says, it's not going to affect your experiencing at all. So that's pretty nice. That's a great thing to be able to say, isn't it? So, this is just a, you know, general talk. We like to talk in general terms, outline everything, and the gist of it is, you don't need to react to what's taking place. Relax. Everything's fine. Everything is fine. The repentance has its vision for you, has its perception for you. It's just waiting for you. Waiting for you, waiting for you. It's not affected by what happens in the world. It doesn't affect it at all. So let the play of impermanence play out. Let it do whatever it wants to do. It doesn't make any difference. The mechanism of repentance, the perceptual mechanism of repentance, everything is lovely. Everything is exquisitely, seamlessly, flawlessly lovely beyond anything we can ever depict in paintings or music or art or anything. There's a depth to the loveliness. There's an endlessness to the loveliness. There's a non-threatenedness to the loveliness, etc. All of this cannot be conveyed. If we do a great piece of art, we're perceiving it how? By the body senses, and the body senses are completely vulnerable. So how can we have a equal appreciation of that art as if when we were seeing the loveliness that repentance, the perception of repentance shows us, where the means of perception are completely invulnerable? How can the two equate? You cannot equate them. It's impossible to equate them. Of course, arrogance says it can. So it says, well, I want art. Give me some better art. We can match that loveliness. And arrogance will push you that direction for sure. It tells you that you should be able to match that loveliness. If you're just clever and shrewd enough and intelligent enough and weren't so stupid, you should be able to do it. But it's the arrogance that's stupid. It's projecting, as it loves to do. It projects its own stupidity upon us and saying that how come we can't do the impossible? We should be able to do that. And of course, that's just us desiring to be prime creator. We desire to accomplish the impossible. So, you know, we have no one to blame but ourselves. So it's our desire that's the problem. Our desire to be prime creator. But we can repent and say, okay, I'm finished with that. I don't want to do that anymore. Then we have a continuity problem with all of this perception, everything we've been perceiving. So we now just perceive it through the perception of repentance, and everything is completely lovely. And the means of perceiving is completely invulnerable and stable. So we still have this dance, as it were, still have thingness, have definitionness. But there's a great stability and a great loveliness to it now. And that's easily then set down and go beyond all definition. Set down definition, set down perception. It's God will take that final step for us. We don't have to worry about that. So these are the things that enable us to skate past the situation that's going on right now. is very thin ice right now. The planet's on very thin ice because nature is certainly getting ready to use its leverage, have its say, okay? And when nature has its say in a leveraged way, that's a whole different ballgame. And I've been certainly warned about that. And tried to warn others, saying, you know, if you don't be so naive. And people are. They don't have no understanding of history of this planet and no understanding of how nature really works and the situation. What is this whole situation? They're just doubling down on their arrogance, doubling down on it all the time. Says, no, we can make this place a lovely place. The attempt to make this world a lovely place, that is the ego's path, that's the Antichrist path. Because the perception of repentance sees everything just as it is right now, totally lovely. Everything. We don't have to do anything. We don't have to change anything, do anything at all. Absolutely nothing. It sees, no matter what there is to see, perceive, it perceives it as lovely. So, we don't have to have any buildings, we don't have to have any things, we don't have to have anything at all. Or we can have a lot of stuff. Either way, it doesn't make any difference. It's all the same. But what the ego tells us is that we don't need the Holy Spirit's the loveliness of repentance. We can keep our arrogance and make arrogance lovely. So we set about that, creating beautiful music and art and beautifying landscaping, parks, flowers, you know, great civilizations, all this stuff, trying to make the world a lovely place. Totally ignoring the fact that who is viewing it? who is viewing it? The body is viewing it, and the body is completely vulnerable. It's also a very unstable perception, and it cannot pick up the exquisiteness that is necessary for true loveliness to be experienced. It cannot at all. It's a very dull mechanism. And so it's all a complete waste of time. Complete waste of time. All we get is the faintest of echoes of loveliness through physical perception, sensory perception, the faintest echoes. It's not nearly enough to overcome the continuity issue. Whereas the perception of repentance is exquisite. The mechanism is exquisite. It has all the correct overtones and subtleties and clarity, etc., etc., to really give us the experience of loveliness, which resolves the continuity issue. It's a package deal that resolves the continuity issue for us. And the stability of the perception is what is crucial. What is doing the perceiving is crucial. So the plan of arrogance is utter folly, which is what arrogance is in the first place, attempt to accomplish the impossible, total folly. And yet arrogance pursues it with great bluff and arrogance. Says, oh no, we need to make the world beautiful. That's our purpose. Humanity's put here to make this world beautiful, and believes that that's a mandate from God. This is why we're here, which is just, again, the voice of arrogance, the ego. Ego is like we call the voice of arrogance. Arrogance asserts itself, and we call it, you know, the ego, but it's really just arrogance. So this just gives us an overview. This talk gives us an overview, because things that are happening now externally are really wacko. I mean, it's just like, whoa. People are stopped. I mean, there are a lot of people who are like stopped in their tracks and say, uh-oh. Whoa, this is getting out of hand. This is totally getting out of hand, what's going on. On many, many, many levels. They say, this just isn't right. Something's wrong. Something's just not right. And we're being told all this, and then we hear all these people saying, this is what's not right. And we say, wait a minute. I think they have that upside down and backwards. And we're getting, the playing field is being tipped. And the definitions are being twisted and distorted. And we're being told, everything's getting out. The whole scale of measurement is being warped and distorted. Everything's getting out of whack. I'm losing my frame of reference. I can see how my, there's an attempt to change my very frame of reference. And you say, uh-oh. You know, this is hardball, what's going on. It's hardball. We're not in softball anymore. This is hardball, what's taking place. So you have to be a real big leaguer right now. Be an all-transcendent. Get ahead of it and transcend it. And that's why these videos are here. I've known this is going to happen all along my whole life, so I decided, you know, I'll try to help out, make these videos, and at least be a voice of sanity in the situation, and explain to people you don't need to react to any of it. No need to react to any of it. That's the ego's game, reacting to it. What we do is, well, we need to realize, oops, you know, trouble is here. And what do we need to do? Oh yeah, we need to repent. Oh yeah. And repentance has its own mechanism of perception. You hear this and you start getting wise. You start wising up. Fortunately, I've led a lifetime of studying all this and was able to get enough from all the ancients so that I have it, you know, with me. Whereas if you try to get it right now in today's society and the way things are, oh boy, you know, good luck with that. You know, as far as starting with your bootstraps, trying to bootstrap yourself up, you know. But I've been able to condense all this and put it all together, connect all the dots, and then present this in very, you know, with quantum simplicity. And that, I certainly feel that helps me just, you know, get past, just skate right past all this stuff and just laugh and say, you know, hey, nice try, ego. Nice try. It's always trying. Some flies actually around here now. Two flies got in the house. And I opened the door. I saw only one first. I opened the door and went zoom right out the door. Closed the door. I saw another one. Opened the door. Zoom right out again. So sometimes you have to know how to open the door. Go away, fly. That is the first time a fly has been around in ages. Interesting. Real pests. Buzzing your ears. We didn't have any flies last year. It's been several years since I've been bothered by flies, actually. It's kind of warm here, but I guess it's really warm in many places. But actually, the evening's beautiful, just beautiful. Friday, and I'm telling you, I told you July, the second half of this year, look out. This is the last July, the second half of last year, was a quantum leap in unraveling. Okay, but this is a quantum leap on top of a quantum leap, okay? So it don't expect it to be way, way worse than last second half of last year. And it's already started out just with incredible mind-numbing confusion and projection and blame and scapegoating and just amazing stuff. And then you listen to different media sources, as I do, and you hear one side, and then you hear the other side, and it's like they must be talking about completely different events. You know, the spin on them is so completely different. It's amazing what the media can do. You got to be very careful. You need to have multiple sources from both sides. Really. Really. If you do this enough, then you're able to pick up which side, is there a side that's truth more closer to the truth than the others, not spinning it so badly. And there are sources like that. There are some sources that have less spin, I would say, than others. But until you really are shrewd and sharp about this, you really need to hear from the right and the left, you know, different, and just say, whoa, wait a minute. It's amazing, you know, the spin, the power of the media to shape the narrative. Power of the media to shape the narrative is incredible. Like living here in the Bay Area, the media here in the Bay Area, the spin they put on is just amazing, the spin. Nothing to see here. It's just incredible. And it's unified. I mean, the narrative here is set in the Bay Area. Very set what the narrative is. And nobody's allowed to step out there. They don't want you to step outside that narrative at all. So you need to widen your perspective, listen to different people, different parts of the country, what their narrative is, you know. But if you just listen to the news in the Bay Area, my God, you will get the most warped picture of what's going on. It's just incredible. I mean, it's just like shocking, absolutely jaw-dropping and shocking. How the audacity and the arrogance to just brush aside, you know, brush aside stuff that's incredibly consequential, as if it's exactly something wonderful. Oh, there's something, how wonderful, you know. Isn't that great? How cute, how wonderful, how great. And then the other perspective would be, this is like, you know, the most worst, one of the worst things that ever happened, you know. And so you look at the various things, and it's not all, the truth is not always in between, you know. Sometimes it's in between, sometimes truth is with one side more than the other, for sure. But what is happening now is very consequential and very much undoing the fabric of society, very much so. Now, some people will want that to happen. They say, this is great, nothing wrong, nothing wrong with this. Things are going exactly as planned. It's wonderful. But there are severe consequences to that down the road. You know, very myopic, very short-term perspective, what's going on right now. And actually, if you knew the whole story, you would be quite alarmed, actually. Because actually, even those that are alarmists don't even know the whole story, really. It's way worse than what they're saying. Way worse. Way, way, way worse. It's so bad that it's hard to even talk about, because people just say, I can't wrap my mind around that. Yesterday evening and today in my taping, I laid out a more thorough exposition of what's going on. And you know, there's nobody's talking about this, because it's very difficult to realize just how terrible things really are. Very difficult. And people just naturally say, no, it can't be that bad. I don't want to listen to that. But there are people who suspect it and are talking about certain facets of it, but they haven't quite connected the dots. And yesterday, the dots are just connected, like, boom. I said, oh, wow, of course, of course, of course. Now I see it. I see it in its raw savagery and duplicity and how terrible it is. And it's like, that could be really disheartening if you see it prematurely. So I try not to lay everything out too overly directly and bluntly. I try not to. I try to slip it in here in a general narrative, in a general overall context, because if you just see one thing and grab a hold of it, it can be really too disillusioning. You need to keep trying to have a wide picture, big picture, and then that will enable you to see the details very truly. And you see something to say, oh, wow, that's really awful. Because what is taking place on this planet is really awful. But you won't be able to see it until you have widened your perspective and you know what salvation is. You know how you can be redeemed. You know repentance has its own means of perception. You know that there's a stable means of perception, that a loveliness you can perceive. You know the Holy Spirit is with you. And all this stuff, if you know all this, then you can see and take a look at how awful it is, and you can see it as it is, and you just like say, oh, my gosh. But it doesn't bother you too much. You just say, okay, all right, I see. And it frees you up from existence, because you say, oh, no way do I want to have anything to do with arrogance. Arrogance is just terrible, as it keeps doubling down. See, arrogance thinks it's very smart. Very smart. And it just keeps doubling down on and thinks it's end in itself. It keeps doubling down and doesn't see the big picture at all. So it keeps turning to arrogance at each step of the way, thinking, I'm going to win. I'm going to win. If I just keep doubling down, I'm going to win. I'm going to win. I'm going to win. And it gets a hold of you and takes you in the most terrible places. And you don't even realize it, because you keep thinking, well, if I just double down one more time, I'm going to win. For sure. And people, everyone's going to love me. Everyone's going to love me. And I'll be totally successful. I'll solve all the problems of the world. And I'll be the savior of the planet. I just double down one more time. And then, oh, maybe just one more time. I know I'm so smart and able to do it last time. And all along, arrogance thinks that it's being super smart, super smart, super smart, super smart. You know, smarter than, you know, just totally smart. And instead of being humble and repentant. Now, repentance is super smart, actually, because it sees how terrible existence is. But arrogance says, no, existence is wonderful. We can make it lovely. We can make it wonderful. Forgetting the, again, what is the means of perceiving all this and experiencing all that? Oh, the body. Oh, gee. Yeah, well, the body can be wiped out like that. In fact, nature can use leverage to just can bring about an extinction level event any second, any moment. Nature can do that. So what's so lovely about that? Plus, nature can wipe out all this stuff we're perceiving. You know, if we think, oh, that tree's so lovely, well, that tree can be dead in a big hurry, like a wildfire. I wonder how, you know, lovely it is, and you have a lovely landscape. Looking out in the mountains, oh my God, it's so lovely, and then suddenly a wildfire starts, and the whole thing goes up in smoke and flames, and it's just charred, and it's just like, oh God, picture devastation, just like that. So we're idiots to place our faith in sensory perception and what we're seeing. It's just totally nothing but sheer arrogance. So then we don't have to be stupid. We can be wise, and we can start to accept, hey, there is another means of perception other than the body. There is another means, and we can make the shift even while we still have the body. Absolutely. That's what many have done. Body, eyes can still be there, sensory perception can still be there. We don't pay any attention to it as far as aesthetics. You know, we can use it to navigate, but there's no, we're not relying upon it for aesthetics, for loveliness. We're not looking through the body's eyes for loveliness. We can look through the body's eyes, if need be, to carry out all our functioning, if we need be. Now, perhaps the vision of repentance can do all of that too, as well. That's possible. But if need be, certainly we can use all the senses to hear the dog barking, whatever. But we're not expecting or getting any of the loveliness from the body senses anymore. It comes from the vision of Christ, the vision of repentance, spiritual vision, perception of repentance. And I didn't turn these lights on here, so it's getting darker and darker. Maybe I'll boost the... Oh, that's enough. I've said enough for now. So, again, take it all to heart. Take it all to heart. This is the work of a lifetime, condensing it all down for you. So you realize, hey, there is a way. There is some hope. There is some hope. We don't have to keep freaking out about what's taking place. It might be amusing, as it is. And it's like a tragic comedy. This tragedy can be interesting, but... You know, we can easily turn away from it. So we can look at it and say, ah, boo, 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 hiss, hiss, hiss. You know, and then next moment say, okay, so we're now back focusing on repentance, et cetera, et cetera. We don't really have to follow the narrative, really. We don't have to take it to heart. We can, okay, yeah, boo. It's like me watching a game now. I can get into it, and then I can just drop it easily and just not be into it at all. It's like that. We can do that. If we need to keep looking like we're useful idiots, we can do that. But meanwhile, we're getting very wise within, very wise. We're wising up to the answer, to the answer. We really are wising up now. It is time to see for sure. All right, that's it.